Hello, teachers. We are back again for another episode about the 1918 Spanish flu. I'm back here with Kenneth Davis. And Kenneth C. Davis is the author of More Deadly Than War, The Hidden History of the Spanish Flu and the First World War. And my name is Jessica Ellison. I'm a teacher educator at the Minnesota Historical Society. And we are on episode 2 of our Spanish flu discussions here. And we are going to talk about the Purple Death. And we will come back to these primary sources in just a little bit. So I'm going to turn it over to Kenneth here. Good morning again.
Good morning, Jessica. It's great to be with you again. And just to recap, we started talking about the Spanish flu. That's not what they called it at first. It was first widely known as the Purple Death, but we'll talk about that too.
Okay, well, and we did talk a little bit about the First World War and the pandemic, but what was the official response to the pandemic?
We have to go back and remember that the pandemic wasn't a pandemic at first. It started as isolated cases of the flu, largely in the United States on army bases, and most people didn't pay too much attention to it at first. There were doctors who were certainly wondering what this very, very violent, virulent influenza was that was striking young men. And that was one of the important things about what came to be called the Spanish flu. It was striking and killing young, healthy men and women eventually, much more so than we think of the flu as affecting senior citizens or very young children and infants. So that was one of the mysteries of this. Now, because they didn't really have a name for it, and no one was really paying attention to it, there was no official reaction at first, in the first phase of what became a pandemic. People were getting sick, soldiers mostly in bases, and they were actually turning blue. Now that happens because you don't get enough oxygen into your lungs, and it's a condition called cyanosis. And so these young men were actually turning blue, choking to death, it's very grim, on their own body fluids. And because they were turning blue, many people first called this disease the Purple Death, because that's what it looked like. One doctor eventually in New York City said that the patients were coming in and they were blue as huckleberries. Blueberries, I suppose, is another way to describe it, and then just dropping dead. So this is a powerful, powerful disease that was really striking and killing people in unusual numbers, and that's why they called it the Purple Death. In the first phase, there was very little official reaction to it. And then because it was the flu and it seemed to be seasonal, it went away as summertime came. But then it returned in even greater numbers and with greater violence and virulence in September, in the fall. And that's when the second wave of what was now called the Spanish flu really hit hard. The official reaction then was to try and quarantine the troops, but it was really too late. And that's one of the lessons we learned from the Spanish flu pandemic, that quarantining, isolating patients as early as possible was one of the key ways to control the spread of this disease, a lesson we're certainly learning again today.
Absolutely. There are so many parallels. I mean, even the word quarantine might not be something that people were familiar with before, and certainly not the word social distancing as they are now. So going on this idea of what people understood about the flu and the official response, can we talk a little bit about the role of censorship and propaganda? What did they play in the pandemic?
Well, that's important because it has a lot to do with the official reaction. Part of the official reaction was to not let this news out, to either censor the newspapers or to outright lie about what was going on, or to lean on the propaganda. And so let me give you some specific examples of that. And the best example in a way is the name the Spanish flu. Spain was a neutral country in World War I. It was not fighting. So unlike the United States or Great Britain or France or Germany, there wasn't such censorship of the newspapers. In those countries, There was no news about this pandemic, this epidemic at that time. It was going to spread and become a pandemic. So the first report of a major epidemic in a European city comes out of Madrid, where the king is sick and millions of people are sick, and they actually shut down the streetcars, social distancing, I suppose you could call it, 1918 version. But the newspapers in Madrid reported this, and it was picked up by wire services and reported in London that Madrid was having this terrible epidemic. Because of that, it became known as the Spanish flu in many places. The Spanish called it the Naples soldier. Germans called it the Flanders fever, Flanders being an important battlefield in World War I. In Russia, it was the German pest. It just went by different names, but finally it came to be called the Spanish flu. But it was largely a result of censorship. Why were they censoring the news? Well, governments, first of all, didn't want to create panic. They thought if everyone knew there was an epidemic, there would be panic, rush to buy groceries. And we've seen that happen with people rushing to buy toilet paper and emptying the shelves. They wanted to keep morale high. It was important to boost the spirits of the soldiers. So you didn't want everybody to be feeling low because there was an epidemic. How would the soldiers feel if that was going on? And finally, they didn't want the enemy, the opposing side, to know that they had been weakened by the flu. So censorship, lies, and propaganda were very, very powerful because they limited information. And we know now more than ever how important good, sound science information is in forestalling the spread of a pandemic. That was just the opposite in 1918 and helped spread this flu.
So many parallels. Every time you said something about the flu, it just really brought up the connections to the coronavirus pandemic that we're seeing today. So it's so important that we're talking about this. So let's take a look at some primary sources that relate to what Kenneth was just discussing. So we see here a piece of propaganda. Halt the Hun. And if we're talking about the words that people use to describe others, that one is a pretty big one. This is another case of how can your students analyze the messages of this propaganda? Observe, think, wonder is a great one to start. You could do a comparison between the Halt the Hun here and the previous episode, Destroy This Mad Brute. It would be a great opportunity for students to think about the messaging that was being put out to Americans. And then I really love this photograph because it brings together in a wonderful intersection the war and the flu. Because here you have a line of soldiers marching in, I believe it's Seattle, and they're wearing face masks. So here we see this intersection of how this flu and this war are so intertwined. And so have students kind of take a look at this and look at the stores that they're walking by and think about it, the situation that soldiers were facing, whether they might die overseas or they might even die in a hospital in the United States. So thank you for joining us for episode 2. I'm going to share with you some resources. This is the bit.ly that will lead to all of the links and resources that Kenneth and I have been talking about. bit.ly/MMore, D, deadly. And if you have any questions, please feel free to send them my way at jessica.ellison@mnhs.org. Thank you so much, teachers, for tuning in, and we will see you for episode 3.